welcome my dear friends on this final day of our three-day event here in New Delhi, India. Once again, I'm very happy to see all of you because you are all marked souls. Marked souls means souls who have expressed their seeking to go back to their true home and have been marked to find a perfect living master and with his help and with his company go back home. That's the meaning of a marked soul. Marked souls can be in two categories. One, who have already completed their course of seeking and are ready to go back home in this very lifetime. And then there are others who are marked to go in the next few lifetimes. I sometimes refer to these two categories, left list A and list B. Many of you sitting here are already in list A, and I congratulate you very much. Some of you who are still struggling with doubts and difficulties and trying to build that kind of faith will also be found by a perfect living master in good time. And when you are ready, you will be initiated and go with your master. The spiritual path, in the teachings of the great master Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh, is not a promise. It is a deal. It's a firm, guaranteed deal. I will tell you a little history. That history is important. The history is about Baba Sawan Singh being appointed as a perfect living master by his master Baba Jamal Singh. As most of you know, Baba Jamal Singh was a disciple of Swami Seth Shivdyal Singh Ji of Agra. And he used to go and follow his teachings. And the Radha Swami teachings came from there. Swami Ji himself did not start the Radha Swami movement. When somebody told him that we are calling your teaching Radha Swami, he said, this is Swami Ji's words recorded. He said, I only started Sant Mat. Now, if these people want to call it Radha Swami, let that also go on. So the word Radha Swami came from there. Since Swamiji was called Swamiji and his wife's name was Radha, many people began to associate this Radha Swami movement as a movement of that man and his wife. This matter again came to the notice of Swamiji of Agra. And he clarified once again. He said, when I said you can keep on using Radha Swami, I did not mean myself and my wife. And he explained in his mind what Radha Swami meant was, Radha Ad Surat Ka Naam, Swami Ad Sat Purush Maan. The Radha is the name of our soul. Every soul is Radha. And our Satpurush, our totality, our God, our Supreme Father is the Swami. Therefore, he said, do not narrow it down to something that is happening here. Anyway, his disciple, Baba Jamal Singh, lived in Punjab, and most of the work of Swamiji was in Uttar Pradesh, in UP. So he asked Baba Jamal Singh that you do work in Punjab, which was confirmed later on, even after his death, by his wife, who said, yes, she told that you should work in Punjab, and he was initiated by Swamiji. So he did everything. Baba Jamal Singh did everything according to the instructions of Swamiji. In fact, he said, Swamiji is doing it, I am not doing it. When the time came for him to nominate somebody as his successor, He called a few of his advanced satsangis. 14 of them were present at that time in front of Baba Jamal Singh. And he closed his eyes for a moment and he opened his eyes and he said, "Sawan Singh, you will do the work after me. This is my last discourse to you 14 people. I'm not going to give any more discourses. Now, Sawan Singh, you will be doing this work." Baba Sawan Singh said, "I see many more advanced satsangis sitting right here amongst those 14. Why me?" And Baba Jamal Singh said, "Let me check that out." And he closed his eyes. And he said, "I will check out for my master." After a few minutes, he opened his eyes. And he said, "Swamiji says Sawan Singh will do this work. Sorry, I can't change it. My master has said so." Now, Baba Sawan Singh was a clever man, I tell you. He was my master, I know him. He raised an issue. He said, "Baba Ji, Maharaj Ji, you are asking me to do this work. You live in a little kutia, a small little hut. I live in a nice house. It will be given to me by the government. I am an engineer. Are you suggesting that I should leave my nice house and nice way of living for the sake of living in a kutia to do your work?" Baba Jamal Singh said, "Let me check it out." So he closed his eyes and after a few minutes opened his eyes. He says, "New Moj has come." And everybody said, "Babaji, what is the new Moj?" He said, "Moj is that Swamiji says that Sawan Singh will not have to live in that kutia. He will live in a house as good or better than what he is living in now." So Baba Sawan Singh was a little happy, but he was still not satisfied. He said, "Maharaj Ji, it is all right, I can stay in a house, but you are telling me and telling everybody there will be a great growth of the number of disciples. You had just a few people sitting there and they used to have a small party and had their own food and they could serve. You say thousands may come here. I live on a little pension. I'm retiring and retiring in 2 years and I will have a very small pension. How do you expect me to feed them with my small pension?" And Baba Jamal Singh said, "Wait, let me check that out." So he closed his eyes and opened his eyes and said, "New Moj has come." And they said, "What is the new Moj?" He says, "Swamiji has said the new Moj is that you will never have to spend anything from your pocket for feeding people. They will bring enough grain and enough seva, they'll feed themselves. Don't worry about that. And that will never end. No matter how many people come, there will always be enough food to run a langar free of charge." And Baba Sawan Singh was still not quiet after this. He said, "You have been telling people that there can be 4 lives after initiation. That the master can, a guru can initiate a person who may not complete his journey to Sachkhand same life, and he will have to come again to complete his journey and may have to come 4 times. In fact, one of the songs they were singing attributed to Swamiji says that there are 4 lives for making progress. Ek janam gur bhakti, janam dusre naam, janam tisre turiyapad, chauthe me nij dham." He says, "You have yourself laid down a timetable that first we only meet a guru and have gur bhakti, we serve. Next life we get initiated. Third life we reach the causal plane and fourth life we reach Sachkhand, our true home. Are you suggesting, Babaji, that you are making me responsible for that and I will be coming four times to take care of the disciples on my care? I am trying to go away myself this life. You putting a responsibility on me that I also should come four times? Thereupon, Baba Jamal Singh said, let me check that out. So he closed his eyes and he opened his eyes. And he said, new Moj has come. They said, what is the new Moj this time? He said, Swamiji has decreed that whoever is initiated by Baba Sawan Singh will go to Sachkhand in the same life and you will not have to come back again. And that was true. That is why we have been calling great master, a great master, Bade Maharaj. He was Bade. His initiation was a perfect guarantee to go back in this life. People changed, no matter what their age was. And they changed and made enough progress in the same life to go back. Why I am telling this story is that when people come to me and say, initiate, I have no power to initiate. And I do not initiate. I follow the instructions of my master. I follow his instructions to the letter. I have never said anything in any discourse, any talk, any conversation that should be outside of the direction given to me by Baba Sawan Singh. Therefore, you should know that when I pass on great master's initiation to you with his authority, with his approval of selection of every person, human being who gets initiated, it is great master's initiation. And the promise that Baba Jamal Singh made to great master holds true even today. And whoever has received great master's initiation will be taken to Sachkhand in the same life. And I congratulate those who get this great opportunity. I do not know of any greater opportunity in this whole universe than that. That is why I say the biggest event that can take place in our life is being accepted by a perfect living master. Great master has proven to me he was a perfect living master, not by his talk, not by his discourses, not even by his love, but by proving and giving something and proving that the same thing is given works completely. I don't want anyone to think that this path of Sant Mat by Baba Sawan Singh is a path of blind faith or it's a new religion. It's not. It's a deal, a guaranteed deal. Whoever gets Baba Sawan Singh's initiation will go back to Sachkhand in this very life in which he gets initiation. Therefore, I cannot pray over praise this master's gift, and whoever gets that is the luckiest day for that person. I don't know any luckier day than that. That is why many of you who have got great master's initiation, I congratulate you. I congratulate you and I wish you complete success in your own trial of what you got. It does not mean that if you don't try, it won't work. It only means that the mind you live with, which creates questions and doubts, you can satisfy the mind also. While you are here, you can satisfy the mind by experience. There is no greater thing than experience. I mentioned to you yesterday, there are some experiences of certainty where there is no doubt left. I mentioned two such experiences. One was that you exist. No proof is needed. Second was when you wake up in the morning, you are awake. No proof is needed. Similarly, no proof is needed where you get a higher experience of a higher wakefulness. The proof will be in the awakening itself. And 1,000 people can come and say, no, you didn't have it, you still have it. Some early experiences, which are glimpses, some glimpses are sometimes shown only for the sake of convincing a disciple that there are things beyond the physical. Because some people tell us, this is the only thing real, there we are living. Nothing else, it's all imaginary, it's all made up. And this is the only reality in which we live here. How can we believe? Unless we see, we can't believe. Therefore, some glimpses of what is happening elsewhere, that it exists, can come. There was a friend of mine in America. I met him many years ago. And he wanted great master initiation. And I said, when the time is right, I will check with my master. If he is ready to give you initiation, I will pass on to you. I am merely one of his sevadars doing his seva. He waited. And then he got initiated. And he said, how soon can I see something inside? I said, it is not difficult. You can sit with me and ask me, I'll ask my master. He sat in front of me. He said, can I now go and see something? I checked with my master. He said, yes. I didn't have to say, I just nodded my head like this. He went into meditation, began to fly to higher regions, right there and then, and said, it is so easy. He was convinced about the whole thing. This is many years ago. He's been trying to get that again, still struggling. He said, what happened? It was so easy. I said, that was a glimpse to convince you what happened. He says, no, you gave me the nod. I want another nod. I said, I gave you the nod because great master said yes. I would not have given the nod. He said, go to great master. I said, this is a secret meeting we have, great master and I. Sometimes I'm meeting him in a quiet place, like a bathroom. Nobody else is there. I can talk to my master. This is more than 20 years ago when this happened. He's still telling me, go to the bathroom and get a nod. In fact, he's propagating this view to everybody. If you want to get anything in life, ask him to go to the bathroom and get a nod. Why I'm telling you this story is that we get glimpses of these experiences just to build the initial faith that there is something which you can get. And that's a very convincing experience. People have a miraculous experience. This is definitely a miracle. And that's so convincing that you are willing to meditate to have the experience again. Why are we given these little glimpses and we never have them again for a while? Because they have worked their way. They have done their duty. The glimpse has served its purpose to make you motivated to meditate and go within and see. I told you the story of King Janak and Ashtabakar. Ashtabakar gave a glimpse to King Janak for 1 second or even less than a second. And he said, I've got the true knowledge. And after that he said, now you meditate for 20 years, you will get it again. How come it's happened in one instant and then 20 years? The one instant is for the mind. There is no obstacle on the way to our true home except our own mind. Nothing is stopping us from going to our true home, to having all the experiences that lie within ourselves, all the treasures that lie inside, except our own mind. Our mind is our greatest enemy on the spiritual path. It doubts. It does many things detrimental to our spiritual growth. First of all, it doubts. And by doubt, sometimes it creates fear. Once, a friend of mine in America brought some nuns from a convent to attend my talk. They were sitting at the back. My friend was sitting there. As soon as they started speaking, they moved their beads and said, "Save our soul, save our soul, devil is here, save our soul." They've got so frightened. Doubt and fear come from the mind. It is a natural thing built into the mind to create doubt, and from doubt comes fear. So doubt and fear are only with us when we are being influenced by the mind. Now, how do we handle this? We handle by an internal experience, which can be a glimpse or more than that. When that happens, even the mind gets convinced there is something. And the worst enemy of ours becomes our best friend. When it is enemy, it prevents us from even meditating. When it's a friend, it says, "Let's meditate more. I want to see more." Our human mind has also this capacity to enjoy pleasure of any kind. And loves pleasure and loves a variety of pleasure. It's also built into it. Therefore, it seeks all the pleasure outside. It is constantly searching for, striving for, working for pleasures outside in this world. Therefore, it thinks there is no pleasure anywhere else except in this world. We try to meditate. He says, "Why are you wasting your time? There's nothing there. Go out this pleasure here in this world." Constantly pulls us out. But when it finds pleasure inside, the same nature of the mind draws it inside. And the mind is no longer a wall. It becomes a clearance, an agent of help. It becomes a helpful agent that the mind itself starts thinking, "When can I have that again? When can I meditate more?" So one good glimpse of reality is able to turn this mind from an enemy into a friend. And that is why it's good if you get initiated by a perfect living master to at least meditate anyhow, somehow, till you get some glimpse inside. Of course, the most useful glimpse would be the inner form of your own master who initiated you. We sometimes call it the radiant form, Nuri Sarup, of the inner master. Why we call it radiant master, radiant form, or Nuri Sarup is because at that state, when you meet him, everything is Nuri, including yourself. And all experiences are Nuri. Everything is like lighted up, like you see. Whatever you see outside here is also inside. Only inside has little more. And here you have little less. But everything you see here, every possible experience you have in the physical world is originating from there. And the original is there, copy is here. That is why you can have all these experiences inside also. But the experience is slightly different. We go to see the flowers here, beautiful colors, but they don't glow like light. Inside, same flowers, but they glow with light. Here, if it is night, we are in the park, we don't even see the flowers because it is dark. Inside, no matter whether it's light or not, whether it's dark or not, the flowers are glowing, you will see them anyway. This particular radiance that exists in everything there, is itself attractive. And the master, when he appears in the same form in which we see him outside, the form changes afterwards. But when we first see the perfect living master who has initiated us, we see him in the same form that we see him outside. When you see, it's radiating, like the flowers. It's light. It does not mean Nuri Sroop or radiant form does not mean there are beams of light coming out of him. It only means that he is visible, illuminated by himself, and can be seen in utter darkness. And that is the radiant form. A radiant form in the beginning comes as a flash, as a glimpse. You see it, it's gone. And you wonder, just your imagination, what happened? It comes, goes. You think, maybe this image is appearing and going. No, it's entirely connected with the concentration of your attention. When your attention on that form is complete, it becomes stable. When it becomes stable, and you can see anytime, then you just enter the phase of meditation. You can talk to the master inside like you talk to him outside. In fact, more confidently inside than you can even talk outside. There is no friendship that I have ever seen in this world that can compare with the friendship of a master in the radiant form that you see inside. Once stabilized, he is with you always. And once he gets always stabilized in meditation, he is there with you even when you are not meditating. He is visible when you are not meditating. You are driving your car, he can be sitting next to you. You are walking, he is walking with you. You are doing something, he is watching and talking to you. And he is like a friend who is ever present with you. It changes your life. It changes your physical life completely when there's somebody always with you. Nobody ever complains, I was lonely sitting alone. It never happens. Not after that. Imagine what kind of friendship that is, where there is no secret amongst us, where everything is known more to our friend than even we know, and that friend is always with us. That's the beauty and wonder of getting the stabilized radiant form inside. That is why Great Master Baba Sawan Singh used to recommend that while he is alive, do as much meditation, put high priority on your meditation so that you get the inner form of the master inside you. And then when he passes in the physical body, you will never feel he died. Otherwise, you'll feel very sorry, my master has died and gone, what will I do now? And you will mourn and groan and do that. If you have done the preliminary part of getting the master in the radiant form while he's alive, you will never know he died. In fact, as soon as he passes in his physical body, he'll stand next to you and you will know he's not dead. It's a beautiful experience. That is why I always repeat this advice. Why I have to repeat it? Because people get initiated and they don't follow up. They think initiation is good enough to keep in their almari or in their cupboard, and one day they will use it. People think one day a time will come when we will use it. One great mystic, Sheikh Farid was a great master, but before he became a master, his own master was also a perfect master, Sheikh Qutbuddin had virtually adopted Farid, and Farid had a son, and he used to tell his son, "Son, my master Sheikh Qutbuddin is getting old, you better get initiated before he dies, because It is only living master who can give you a real initiation. Dead masters can't do it. When somebody thinks I have been initiated by a master who died, he is getting initiated by his own mind. His own mind is making up all that. It's a living person who is not your mind, another mind. If that person initiates, it is not your mind initiating. Therefore, he said, Qutbuddin is old. Please get initiated while he's there. One day, of course, the son said, I am still young, you know, I can wait. Well, this meditation is for older people. I have to live my life, like most young people say today. And one day, Qutbuddin died. As all masters in their physical bodies die, we all die, without exception. There is no exception that somebody didn't die and the others died. Death is a rule. It's a certainty. If somebody is born, make no mistake. His death is certain. He's just waiting for it. Birth is waiting for death. And then how long you wait is your life. But you have to die. Qutbuddin died. And the son heard that Qutbuddin is dead, but he has not been buried yet. His body is still lying. He ran and quickly shaved his head off, which was customary at that time for initiation. He shaved his head and put his head on the feet of the dead master's body while Farid was looking on. He said, my son, this is the body of somebody I have loved more than anything else. And yet, you got nothing out of it. Master has gone. Even 1 second is too late to get initiated from a dead master. Therefore, he said, you missed the chance to get initiated. But since Qutbuddin had named Farid himself as a master, later on his son got initiated by his own father. But the story is relevant that we don't realize that living masters are rare. There are so many masters. There are so many gurus in this world. Great master used to say there are today more gurus than disciples. There are more teachers coming to teach than students to learn. It's become almost a business. People enter into the business, I can run a store, I can open an office, or I can be a guru. They talk like that. And they make money out of this. No perfect living master has ever charged for his service to people. He has not come to take, he's come to give. How can he be charging something? That makes it business. It's not spirituality, it's not santhmat. When masters come, they take you up to a certain stage depending upon where they have gone. Some have gone to the first stage and seen that the whole creation has taken place from there. Therefore, they say that is our Sachkhand. They believe it. They initiate you. They take you to the first stage and say, welcome to heaven. This is Sachkhand. And we get trapped there and can't do anything more. Other masters find that there are disciples who are seeking to go true home, but have been trapped there and getting experience only of that place. They come forth and take them further, depending upon where those masters have reached. Those who have reached the top of the Trikuti, of the causal plane, where the whole creation has been built from concepts, not even material things, not even ideas, but the concepts have been created into ideas and made into different universes and worlds. And when they go there, they discover that is universal place from where everything has come. Because all minds, which look like individual minds here, They are all coming from one mind in the causal plane in Trikuti. And since they reach one mind, universal mind, they say that's where everything is coming and that is our Sachkhand. They believe it. Not that they're telling a lie to anybody. They believe it. That is Sachkhand. Many disciples of theirs are there, have reached that point, some have not. But those who have reached there, in a way, according to me, they are stagnating there. Because they thought this is all they want. But those who, in spite of having that experience, still feel, no, we want to go to our true home, not the home of our mind. We want to go to the home of our Atma, our soul, not the home of our mind. And this thought comes to them, this seeking comes to them. And that will come if you are marked soul, automatically. When that seeking comes, another master appears in your life. Perfect living master takes you up. Don't think that every master is taking you to Sachkhand. He's taking to what he thinks is a Sachkhand, up to his capacity. Your seeking, if it is only for that which is the capacity of the master, you'll get it. If your seeking is beyond that, you will have to be found by another master who takes you further. And eventually, if your seeking is for the true home of Atma, which merges and becomes one Paramatma, who becomes one with the totality of consciousness and totality of all creation, if such a person, if your seeking is for that, a perfect living master from that level will come into your life automatically. It's not a matter of searching. I'm not saying search for such a master. Masters will come by coincidence, by chance in your life. And the master who takes you to your true home, Sachkhand, always comes by chance, by coincidences. We looking for something else appears. We are going some other place and we suddenly find a friend who's telling us to go somewhere else. All kinds of strange coincidences happen. And we think by chance, by coincidence, we have found a master. No, the master arranges to appear through these coincidences. He creates the conditions by which he comes into contact with you. And you say, I found a master. Not a very true statement. Truth is, master found you. It is like supposing there are a number of blind people in a little room and they don't know where the door is because the door is flush with the rest of the wall. So they are going about putting their hand on the wall to find where is the door. They are all roaming around and they can't find the door. And a man with eyes open comes into the door inside. And he watches these people. And they know somebody has come. Who has come from outside can take us outside. But we don't know where he is. They are still groping against the wall. And the man who has come with eyes, he watches these people. One of this person is really desperate to go out. He goes and holds his hand and says, let's go out. And the man says, I found the master. He was blind. How could he find the master? The master found him. He gave him his hand and he said, I found the master. That is how we get the feeling that we are somehow responsible for finding a master. Whereas it's entirely the master's power that picks up the marked soul whose time is ready to go back home. It's an all pre-arranged thing, all predestined thing. But the experience of feeling, I found the master, is okay for the mind. Later on you find that you found nothing. Everything was found by the master. You did not even know where you are. You did not know why you were in a physical place, in such and such town, such and such place, why you were living at that age. You don't even know that. Master knows that before he has ever met you. Master knows you before you ever came into this world. It does not mean Master knows you when he initiates you. Master knows you as a marked soul from inception. That is why many people, when they get initiated, they suddenly get an experience. We have known this before. We knew this person before. We knew whoever he is before. Because the fact is, you did, but did not or not aware of it. Master was aware of it. He is preparing you. Even when he is not there, the same Master who is a perfect living Master and will take you to your true home is preparing you when you don't even know him, because he knows you. When you go before a perfect living Master, he is an ordinary human being. He talks to you simply like ordinary friend, ordinary person. And he says simple questions just for the sake of questions. He does not need to ask any questions. If he knows you are a seeker, he knows you are a marked soul, why would he ask questions? It's not necessary to ask questions when you already know who that person, who that soul is. When he looks at you, he is not looking at your body. He is not looking at your thoughts. He knows what you are thinking. He is looking even beyond, at your soul and the soul seeking and readiness to go back home. If this were not so, that spark of love that comes so suddenly and so strongly would never come. It comes because of that connection with the soul. There was a man in America who came to me first time. And he brought a flower, one red rose, and he wanted to give it to me. He came, little elderly, in his 40s or 50s, man, not a young boy, grown up man. He brought a rose, carrying it like this. And I saw the rose, and I just happened to put my hand on his head for a moment. He had been telling it all his life to everybody. It was the first time I experienced true love. When he held the rose in his hand and I was just giving him a little pat on the head. And that was a lifelong experience for him, he told everybody. He left his place, left the job and said, where will the headquarters of the new spiritual center be? I said, centers will be all over. They will be centers of spirituality, then they will become centers of religion. It always happens. When numbers grow, that contact of friend to friend disappears. Therefore, center is only a temporary thing. The buildings outside do not make spiritual homes. The spiritual center and home is only our head, and the center is inside. Outside we make arrangements for logistical support, to have a place to gather and to do other spiritual activities, have a langar, dera, all these things are merely meant for just help in assembling together. That is not spirituality. To come and have feast together, to have a langar together, does not make spiritual place. Spiritual place is inside. But just for the sake of help, we set up these centers. I said, in memory of my master, Baba Sawan Singh, I am planning a center in America, in the state of Wisconsin. And it was a very strange coincidence, you might say, which led me to decide that the center should be on the bank of a river. River's name is Chippewa River. On the bank of that river, the center should be. How did it happen? I heard a story about Baba Jamal Singh, finding the place where the current Dera Baba Jaimal Singh exists on the river Bias in Punjab, India. Baba Jaimal Singh had no center. He was a military man, ex-military man. He used to go to Agra to see his master, went to his own village near Gurdaspur. And he went there and he was just going, no center. When he was asked to do this work on behalf of Swamiji, he was walking with a few friends along the river Bias. And when he came to the spot where today the Dera of Baba Jaimal Singh stands, he saw a man wildly moving his arms and saying, "This will be a big city." And he said, "This will be the center." And he built a couple of rooms, a small mud rooms, and shifted himself from Gurdaspur district into that center. The center has grown into a big city today. Just because that madman was shouting. Interesting story. Baba Sawan Singh used to tell us, as it happened, as his disciple, and having heard from him that there will be center and shift of axis of spirituality to the West and localized in United States of America, which he told Dr. Johnson, Julian Johnson, and wrote in 2-3 letters to the Americans at that very time in 1937. I said, there must be some place here. There will be centers, maybe at least one will be there. With some friends, 3 or 4 friends, I was walking in that area because a lot of meditation resorts were already along that river. I said, let's see, we are walking. And one of our own guys started shouting like a madman, crazy man. "This is it, this is it." I said, "This is the scene being repeated." I said, "This is it. That's where I'm trying to build a small center, calling it Dera Baba Sawan Singh, as a tribute to my own master and to a tribute to his prediction that true Sant Mat will spread in a big way in the West." He said, "Sant Mat, true spiritual teachers have been coming in the East. Big teachers, big perfect masters have come in China, India, come in Middle East. You can name many of them. West was bereft of that. What they were doing when these Eastern countries were searching for spiritual truths, those people were busy making more money, opening more industry, more factories, more business, and they thought that the money was God. In America, they have a currency called the dollar bill. It's very interesting. I don't know how many of you have seen a dollar. If you see a dollar, whoever printed it had something in his mind, because on the back of the dollar bill, on the dollar note, currency note, there's the shape of a pyramid, and inside that is a single eye, third eye. A message is right there that if you want to have real money, this is paper. Real money, see the other side of it and go to the third eye in this pyramid. Many mystics have earlier mentioned that this meditation chamber of ours is like a dome. Some have mentioned it is like a pyramid. Some have mentioned like a well that has been turned upside down. Some have mentioned in other forms that there are other lights up there. And we have made our places of worship according to those descriptions. That means when we go to a temple and we see the round dome on it, we go to a Buddhist monastery and see the dome, go to a church and hear bells on a dome. These were symbols outside, made for to symbolize what is actually inside, and they are copying the head and sometimes the headgear that was worn at that time. That is how they made it. So therefore, these outside places are mere symbolic. When that man said this, this is the place, I said, let's make a dome. People will think this is an outside dome, and I am referring to an inside dome to see that. You should think which is the real dome. I'll write on it. This dome is a reminder of the real dome on the top of your bodies. I know. Even today I know, one day they will remove that writing and say, this is the dome. Inside that you will get spirituality. Great Master built a small building, not very small at that time, which we called Satsanghar, where Satsang was held. He built this because when I was young, that building was not there, and the number was very small. When I was very small, and we used to go to Dera, the Dera was a very small collection of a few mud huts, and one house was being built, in which Great Master then lived. That house also was built around the two little huts in which Baba Jamal Singh lived, and they were made as part of the small little rooms inside the main room after entering. Great Master used to enter that room, small room, which was Baba Jamal Singh's actual residence at one time, on 29th of December every year. 29th of December was the day, perhaps in 1903, when Baba Jamal Singh passed away in his physical body. He would go there. I had the opportunity. He took me in a couple of times, two times. That is the only time I saw tears in his eyes. Tears of extreme devotion, not tears of pain. Tears of a strange joy which I never seen elsewhere. The Dera was built around it. The Satsangar was moved because the number grew large. And what was originally the Satsangar was converted into a little place where they just placed the holy Guru Granth Sahib there, from where he used to give a lot of his discourses. When that becomes small, they made a larger room and made it into a library, number grew. Ultimately, he said, we can make a large one with pillars and minarets and make it attractive even from a distance. People should know that is the Satsanghar, that is the place where you can go for spiritual discourse. So he made a beautiful Satsanghar, we still stand there. And we did seva for that. We had to carry bricks, it's made up of bricks. I remember, I carried one brick. My friend, who was a mastana from Balochistan, he carried a whole basket. But we used to talk while doing it seva. We talked about what Master has given us, what experience we are having. And we could share some of these things with the Balochistani mastana. Brick by brick, the whole thing came up and became a nice place for discourses. Great Master has passed away. His successors have come one after the other. I went last time and they said, do you want to go to Sachkhand? I said, I think I would like to. My master promised me. He said, no, we can go. I said, where is it? It's right outside there. They are calling that building made for holding a meeting and holding a satsang, calling it Sachkhand. They are saying that is sanskarn. You just enter the building, you are in sanskarn. And if you don't think you are in sanskarn, just climb up the steps of one of those minarets, one of the sides. Just go step. First two steps, astral plane. Two more, causal plane. Now you are on sanskarn. This is what we do of buildings. We think buildings are carrying sanskarn. But it happens always. It happens because the spiritual teachings are not carried too far at the same place or same time, because the number grows so huge it becomes religion. The external things, the external buildings become more relevant. The working of those buildings become more relevant. The functions become more relevant. And the truth which lies in this satsanghar, the real place to find satsanghar, is lost. We carry satsanghar with us and run to a building to find satsanghar. What a big mistake. We are carrying our satsanghar with us all the time. We don't have to run anywhere. We have to stop running. We run either on our feet or we run with our mind. Both of them are useless. Whether we run with our feet or we run with our mind by thoughts, they don't take us to satsanghar. You should stop running. Stop running. Stop going anywhere. Stay where you are. It's here. Satsanghar is here, nowhere else. Somebody sent me a nice song sung by a Pakistani singer. Pakistani girl, very beautiful voice. And it's a song in Multani accent. I don't know if people from Multan would understand that accent. And the words are, opening words are, ith nahi te kith nahi. Which means, if it is not here, it is nowhere. The only place you can find satsanghar, your true home, is here, not anywhere else. But you know, we convert spiritual teachings into physical ceremonies and rituals. And that is the birth of religion. All religions have been born like that. You go back to their origin, you would find that the teachings of the original founders of religion were not at all what they are doing now. The teachings were, find the truth within yourself. And we are trying to run to outside buildings we have made. Great Master predicted that these buildings will be called satsanghar. He said so while they were building it. And he said, while he's alive, his own assistants, his own secretaries and people around him are trying to make his teaching into a religion. They are doing more do's and don'ts than he ever suggested. This tendency among us to stay outside is a tendency because of our mind. We try to do everything with our minds. You have come here. I am very happy to join you because I could convey to you what great master Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh taught. What he told us is the reality. And I am not telling you because he said so. I am telling you because you can verify it. You can practice it. And I also urge you not to believe all he says till you find it true yourself. In true spiritual path, there is no place for blind faith. End with a little story. Two young boys lived in Bombay, which is now called Mumbai. Two young boys, Mumbai. They liked ice cream. And some good ice cream is sold at Juhu Beach. Many of you have seen that beach. I have also seen. So one day, the two boys said, let us go and have some ice cream. And one boy said, I have 5 rupees in my pocket. I will treat you. The other boy did not have any money, so he was happy to go. with 5 rupees in the pocket of one of the boys, they went to Juhu Beach to buy ice cream. Before they could reach the ice cream stall, they saw an old man making sand houses, sand castles, different buildings with sand. And they stopped to see, because he was making very beautiful sand houses with reth, sand. And they looked very pretty. The boy who had the 5 rupees in his pocket, he said, "Sir, can I buy one of these houses?" He said, "Do you have the money for it?" He said, "How much is it?" He said, 5 rupees. He said, "Yes, I have the money." "Okay, I like this house very much." He gave 5 rupees, went and got a plywood from somewhere and picked up the house on that plywood, the sand house, and took it with him. Other boy cursed him. "We came for ice cream. You wasted your money on sand. What good is it?" He said, "No, I like this. That is why I picked it up." Anyway, that boy crying that we never got ice cream, the other boy happy, he got a nice sand house. They both went back home. At night, the boy who cried and did not get the ice cream, he had a dream. In the dream, he felt he was flying in the sky. And he saw in the distance a lot of lights. As he was flying, he saw those were houses made of light. They were very beautiful. As he looked at them, he said, "They look like the houses the man was making with sand. Same design." He was very surprised. He said, "That man was no ordinary man. He was making houses from heaven. They were all full of light." As he was flying around the houses, he saw one house exactly like the one whose friend had bought for 5 rupees. And as he approached that house, outside the house, he saw the name of his friend written. He said, "Oh my God, this man has for 5 rupees bought a house in heaven. I was such a fool to think ice cream is more important than a house in heaven for 5 rupees. And he woke up. And he ran to that friend. He said, "You got a sand house yesterday for 5 rupees. Can I give you a little profit? I'll give you 10 rupees and buy it from you." And he said, "No, why should I sell? If you want to buy a sand house, go to the same man. He'll still be there making sand houses. Buy your own house." So he ran to the beach and he saw the man still making sand houses. So he said, "Can I buy one of these houses?" He said, "Of course." "Have you brought the money?" He said, "Yes, twice the money. I have 10 rupees with me." He said, "But these houses don't cost 10 rupees. They cost 5,000 rupees each." He said, "What kind of inflation is this? Yesterday was 5 rupees. Today it has become 5,000 rupees. How can that be?" He said, "Look, my young child, that friend of yours came and bought the house without seeing the house in heaven. He bought it on faith. You have come and seen the house, and then you are buying. You have to pay full price. If you get anything on faith, you get a big discount." That was the lesson we heard about faith from a simple story. I am again very happy to see all of you. There are some people who are still waiting to see me, and I will try and come back, because they said the lunch will be ready after 2 o'clock. It's after 2 o'clock now, so please enjoy your lunch, and those who have to go, please go back home safely. I wish you all safe travels back to your places where you came from, and I'll remember nice meetings I've had with you, and the nice langar I've had with you, and the nice friendship I've had with you. Is the most important thing. And I hope I'll be able to see many of you once again somewhere, sometime. Thank you very much.